How are you? I just had to run and grab a bunch of books. I ran downstairs to grab a stack. And I think I've got... Oh, let me get YouTube going here. Let's see. So you're the only one here! And are you still here? Because, is it live? Is it working? It seems to be. Okay, Gigi, if you're still here, give me a sign. Hey, Sharon. I was too, and I thought this would be a whole lot easier just doing a live tutorial to be able to answer questions and discuss it, because it's one of those things that when the questions come up, that's what the tutorial needs to be. I'm looking for another book I've got over here. I thought I had over here. Well, I thought I had that other book here that I had pulled to actually rip pages out of. Hey, Margie! Margie, Gigi, and Sharon, if you send the link, I'll come in. Okay, cool. Let's see here. Let's get this link. Let me, Sharon. Here you go. Okay, now let me go back. All right. Okay, when Sharon pops up, I can bring her in. Sharon, when you pop up, give me just a minute because I know I brought two more books in earlier and I really wanted to grab those too. But I don't remember where I set them and I might have left them out by the couch where I was going through them. That is entirely possible. Looking for a bright yellow. I think it was bright yellow. Okay. Well, I don't see it, so. All right. I did send the link to Sharon, and I'm not sure what tutorial she was going to record, but maybe it'll fit in with this one. So, Gigi, I just saw your message. I'll just pull something for you. Okay. How's that? I can do that right after this. Margie. let's see. What time is it? Julie's place. It's 3 o'clock, 3, 4, 5. It's 7 o'clock tomorrow morning at Julie's, which would be Thursday. And she works on Thursday. So, hey, Kathy. If she happens to see it on in the morning, she'll probably turn it on while she's getting ready for work. If she doesn't see it, then we know she's going to work. Otherwise, she'd jump on and support us too. So, okay. So the other Saturday night when we were talking about art journals, sorry, I'm adjusting the camera there a little bit. I really want to get it down closer, a little bit closer. But I can't twist the thing that that loosens, the one that needs to go down. I can't get it to twist. I'm going to have to get some brawn in here later. But hang on a minute. I think I could do this. Well, hi, Lucy. Don't let me make you dizzy. I think I can get it closer. Let's hope this isn't too close when I finish this. Tilt a little bit. Okay, how's that? Is that better? Time traveler. Yeah, she is. That better? It seems a little bit closer. I'm thinking that will be a little bit easier to see the books. Okay, there's Sharon. Let's see. There's Sharon. Hey.
Hi. Can you hear me?
I'm doing. I can hear you. And I see you. You're live.
So I just painted my nails and I was cleaning my desk up and I to film a tutorial. And so I had to put all the other stuff away. Sorry, yeah. It took so long.
I was going to tell you the other night that your nails looked really nice.
Oh, thank you. Well,
what were you going to do the tutorial on?
Do you guys want a sneak peek?
Well, no, I'm just asking like topic. What was,
I have a 5-step cluster band.
Oh, nice.
And the thing is I broke it down into steps because a lot of people are intimidated by the clusters or they're, you know, like they just don't like the way
what
process goes. So I actually broke down into 5 awesome steps. And I'm just going to show you guys one real quick. And I'm figuring out where my middle is because I flipped my camera around.
That is middle.
Yeah. Okay. So that is your sneak peek right there. And I've got a five-step process.
Oh, I like it. I hope you get that recorded today because I'm anxious to see that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I sat down to record this, the tutorial that I promised on Saturday about how to prepare a book for an art journal or an altered book. And then I thought it'll be a lot easier to do it live because then there's the discussion and the questions, because that's always what the issue is. Hang on just a second. I got to run to the door.
Hey, is my space really dark? My camera seems to block where my light is hanging because I have a new camera angle, and the ceiling light I made to hang over the desk, it blocks. So I'm wondering if I need to turn on an additional light. What do you guys think? Can't see my list here. There's a triangular shadow. That's my light that I hung, and my phone is actually blocking it. That is my issue. I was trying to figure out other light alternatives, but this little, I put a little lamp on the side, but it is way too bright. See, it's just so bright and it almost hurts my eyes. I can't even see it yet in the picture. It also blocks the computer, so I don't know if I can use that one. Might be able to move it. I don't know. I wonder if I can put it someplace else. Let me see how long this cord is. Might take up some desk space, but how's that? I think I can handle that for today until I figure it out.
Always impeccable timing. Okay, so is it a little dark for Sharon or for me or both?
It was dark for me, and I'm kind of adjusting a lamp right now. It's kind of tippy.
You look dark to me.
Yeah.
Okay.
Ugh, it's an annoying lamp too. It needs a shorter bulb or something. I don't know. It's like sticking out. Yeah. I don't know what the deal is with it. So it's like a light bulb in my face, you know, I'm trying to figure it out.
Yeah, it's pretty orange.
Yeah. Let me run down and grab a different bulb while you're back.
Okay. Yeah. I want to get this tutorial started. I didn't want it to be a 3-hour deal, but people could watch. So
yeah, absolutely. Okay. I'll be right back. I'm going to go grab a different bowl.
All right. That looks like it should be light enough. I'm going to move that over just a hair. Get it all in there. Awesome. Okay. So how many of you that are here have actually decided after Saturday that you want to start an art journal? Or have you already started one? Did you have one before? Have you thought about doing one, didn't know how to start or where to start, or just never got around to it, that kind of thing? Tell me where you are with art journals. Kathy, Margie, and Gigi. Art journal, anyone? Although, you know what happened in 3 hours to Gilligan. Yeah, really. Yeah, that's true. That was one of my favorite shows. I want to kind of look at what the delay is. So it helps me. Let's see here. Okay, I'm going to do this. Wow, the delay isn't bad. It looks like it's about 8 seconds is all. That is actually not bad at all, if that's accurate. Bible seminars. Yes, I remember you said, Gigi, that you do art journal in your Bible, your Bible journal. A lot of people handle that differently. So you may do more art in them than some do, which I love. But different kind could be cool. Have to find a good book, though. Okay, Kathy, never done an art journal. Kathy, do you have interest in doing an art journal? Margie, not into the art journals, but I just see others make them. Okay, totally get that, too.
Okay, I'm back. Different makes
sense. You're still kind of orange.
What's that?
You're still pretty orange, pretty yellow orange. Okay. So here's the thing on... on an art journal. I thought about making one for a long time, and I wanted to, but I always felt like an art journal should be some specific thing or some specific way, or all these people that were quote real artists, you know, that were painters and things like that. That's what they did, and I probably didn't fit in that category, so. You know, maybe I shouldn't do it because maybe I just wouldn't be any good at it. You know, all those things. So, and then I watched a few art journal tutorials and videos, and I read a little bit about art journals, and I realized that an art journal isn't a specific thing. It really isn't defined in a specific way. It's, a book, which you call a journal only because you're putting something into it on a regular basis. Hey, Julie. Yeah, we thought if you woke up and saw it, you might join us before you get to work. Time traveler, Julie. That's awesome. But an art journal is really just a place for you to go let out your creativity. And so for some people, that could be pencil drawing. I know people that are really good pencil drawers. That's all they do. They don't do ink or paint or any of that, but they're really good pencil drawers. And I would love to be able to do that. I know others that are good with different kinds of paints. It might be tempera paints or oil paints or acrylic paints or India ink or, you know, different things like that. Oh, are you on holiday today? What is the holiday today, Julie? Dying to know. I think it's only about an 8-second delay for me, it appears to be. So when you type in, I should see it pretty quickly. So someone who is a quilter, their art journal might be full of, oh shoot, I didn't even think to grab that. I should have. I have a quilt square that is different kinds of fabric sewn together, and each strip is sewn together with a different stitch, and it's basically just trying out all the different stitches. National Rue Day, annual leave. Well, yay, Julie, we're so happy that it's annual leave day. See, we did this just for you. That's funny. I like National Rue Day. I love kangaroos. They're cute. Or National Joey Day. So, you know, a quilter might do an art journal that has different patches, you know, different quilt squares or shapes of things that they've quilted together and show, you know, different techniques and things like that. And then maybe they write a little bit beside them. Maybe they don't. An art journal does not have to have writing in it at all. Unlike the, you know, other diaries or daily journals or emotion journals or, you know, different things that we keep, that we actually write in. This is your second week of 4-week annual leave. So you're off for 2.5 more weeks? Julie, that's awesome. We're going to have to do some craft along with me's because you're going to be available that we can just all of us come hang out. Margie, Gigi, Kathy, everybody who's available, come hang out and craft together so we can see Julie more. That's awesome. So, you know, I look at that and I say, all right, so for me, I'm a paper crafter. I'd like to be able to draw, but I can't really. But every now and then I get this itch to try something. I don't really paint pictures, but I would love to. Every now and then I get an itch to try, you know, to try painting something. You know, all those different things. So it doesn't even matter what kind of art it is. But paper crafting, well, I take paper and make them into pretty things. And that's what you guys do too, on top of all the other, you know, crocheting. You could do a crochet art journal. Crochet cool different squares, you know, and put it in there. Or a flower and then a square, you know, whatever else. Maybe you can crochet a tree or, you know, a bird or something that I couldn't do. So I'll bet, Margie, seeing that afghan that you did, I'll bet that you can crochet a bunch of things. So you could make an art journal just out of things that you've crocheted. So when you think of an art journal in that perspective, it's not as overwhelming. It's not overwhelming at all, because an art journal is just me. It's just you. And on top of that, you never have to show an art journal to anyone, ever, at all. So if you want to try the coloring or the drawing or, you know, any other technique that you've been thinking about or looking at, and maybe you follow a tutorial and try to draw what they did. I've written down I drew a couple of sketches of when I was watching a tutorial of what somebody did on an art journal page, because I thought, okay, that looks pretty simple. I think I might like to try that. So maybe I'll want to try that in my art journal. But I feel the freedom to try whatever I want to try, because I know that I don't ever have to show my art journal to anybody. You know, nobody's going to see it. Hang on just a second. I'm having things pop up on my, there we go. Okay. Because I know nobody ever has to see it. Here, Lucy, look. Go get that one. There you go. So if I think to myself, when I do this, somebody's going to see it, I get much more in my head and hung up, because I'm worried about the end result. I'm concerned about somebody else's opinion. And I get stuck. It was that thing in school when the teacher, you know, has an assignment of write about this, or hi, Lucy, baby, or draw this. I can't do that. And then I'm, you know, I know the teacher's going to look at it and be judging it. And I just get in my head and get stuck and can't do it. And so when you think about the art journal, first thing is think that nobody else is going to see it. Therefore, it doesn't matter what's in there. The second thing is, if you do something and then you come back the next day or the next week and you look at it and you go, man, I don't even want to keep looking at that. I don't like it. Maybe I needed to do that because of how I was feeling that day, but I don't even want to keep looking at that. Then you just do something over it. You can just take some acrylic paint and paint over it, or some gesso, or in our situation, an easy thing is to take a piece of paper, rip off anything that's, you know, 3D above the paper, and then just cover it with a piece of pretty paper and start over. Do something different. And that's exactly it, Margie. If you decide, I've learned to leave it and then come back to it and look at it later. It's kind of like the word that you repeat over and over and over and over, and pretty soon that word doesn't even sound like a real word to you. It just sounds funny, and your lips start going cockeyed and you don't even know if you're pronouncing it right. You know, there's a name for that. I can't think of what it's called, but it's kind of that way when you're working on any art project, when you've looked at it and thought about it and done something with it for so long, whether it's, you know, an hour or 2 hours, or everybody's different. Pretty soon your eyes and your brain start to contort and only see certain things. So I have learned to just leave it and walk away and come back you know, the next day or a couple days later, or whenever you get around to it. Time really doesn't even matter. So I will tell you, Saturday night, that page that I was putting together, I wasn't very crazy about it. I felt like I wasn't really focused, because you know, I'm talking to you guys, and that to me was the most important and most fun of the night. But I was still trying to see what I was feeling or thinking and, you know, what wanted to come out to the page. But I really didn't like it much. I wasn't crazy about it. So I just left the book. I left it open, left it sitting on my desk, and I walked away. I walked past it on Sunday, but I didn't stop and look at it. And then Monday, I looked at it and I sat down in front of it, and I still left all the parts and pieces that I had around, you know, sitting on my desk. I just left it there. So when I came back on Monday and sat down, I started picking things up and adding things to it. And all of a sudden, I liked it. All of a sudden, it came together. So, you know, it doesn't always come together. In fact, I think things rarely come together completely in one sitting, you know, in one process of creating. Do you ever, you might, I can't, and I'll be surprised if you do. Do you ever sit down and make a journal of any kind, a junk journal or a theme journal or any of those, start to finish? Sit down, make the cover, make the pages, embellish them, you know, put the ephemera in, do everything so that from the time you start to the time you finish is all one setting and that book is ready to give away or sell. Does anybody ever do that? I can't do that. It depends on the day, how long I can work on it. And then I have to do something else. I have to come back at it. I have to look at it, let things mull around after I look at things and then think about them. And, you know, and come back to them in that way. So I really think it's the same with an art journal page, that when you come back, things will be mulling around in the back of your mind and you'll be able to continue. And, you know, Sharon brought up a good point one time when I was talking to her and think, whoops, what happened? Why does my screen keep bringing up a whole nother screen? Wow, I don't know what's going on with that. Come on. Okay. Margie, you can do it in one because the cats make me come out of my stamp room. Kathy never does it. Margie doesn't do it. Julie, a small one yesterday thinking it was finished, but woke up thinking add this and add that. So I added this to it, but not yet that. Okay. So, and you know what? A little small one, you know, something like this, maybe you would be able to. But even a small one that Julie thought was finished when she went away and her mind, you know, was, you were thinking about it even through your sleep and, oh, come on.
Fresh eyes. That's what it is.
You come back to it and you know, your brain is telling you what it needs, what your heart and your soul, when you really didn't think that you were thinking about it, but you were, you know what I mean? So that's what's cool about it. And so I just encourage you never to make a judgment on the first thing. But the point that Sharon brought up to me one time was, you know, artists, if you've noticed, artists don't generally care to let people see their work before it's finished. And like somebody who maybe paints oil paintings or portraits or things like that, they start them and then they always cover them. And then they come back and work on them and cover them. And there's a reason they do that. The reason is because in between the start and the finish of the beautiful masterpiece, there's a real ugly stage.
There always is.
Yeah, sometimes that ugly stage is a very long process. It's literally a short beginning, a short end, and a long ugly in the middle. Sometimes it's a short ugly stage, and then it starts to take shape as they do other things, and there's a lot of that. So you never know. But that's why artists don't really like to show people their work. People are like, oh, let me see it so far. They don't want to show it because there's an ugly stage and they're not proud of it at that point and they don't feel good about it and they don't think it represents them or their artistry or, you know, what the end result is going to be, and they wouldn't want somebody to think of it as that. So
a little piece of your soul, you're kind of open, like, yeah,
this is my ugly stage. Progress photos. Yeah, no, we love your progress photos, Julie. What I think that does is give permission to people to see progress in their own and know that it isn't perfect until it's perfect. It isn't perfect until it's done and you say it's done. And then done is perfect. Does that make sense? So when you do an art journal page, and mine from Saturday was a perfect example, I felt like it was in the ugly stage and I couldn't get past the ugly stage at the live. So I just left it. And then when I came back on Monday, I was able to complete it. And now I really do like the page. And when I zoom in, when I looked at the picture, because they never look like they do in real life, you know, but when I zoomed in, it was even better because the colors were different zoomed in. And that was just pretty cool. So it's art journaling is just, it's a fun thing. One time I opened up the book and I took a new pack of, gel crayons or one of those, you know, from one of the companies. And I didn't know really how they worked. So I just took them and I started scribbling on it. And I used my finger to smear it around and see what it did. And then I took the next one and went next to it. And I did the same thing. And then I smeared them together to see how they blended. And then I took some water to it. You know, I reinforced that page a couple of times, but it can be for trying a new technique. It can be for just splatting something down. It can be because you did some spray pages and, you know, your mop-up pages and spray pages you really loved because of the combination of color. And then you used it in a journal, but you just really loved it. And so you go to a page in your art journal and you spray it with those same colors just so that you can look at it. I mean, I love to look at pretty paper and pretty fabric. It's just so pretty. So it's a good
way to play with new supplies too. Yeah.
Oh, that's true. And you could do one that's just new supply. Try, you know, you can play with it. And try different things with your inks, but it's really anything that you want. So, but the first thing, and what everybody always asks is what book do I use? How do I know what book to use? How do I get a book ready to use? So I just ran downstairs and I grabbed a bunch. It's like five books, because this one is the one that I'm using that I started on Saturday. And so I'm going to look at these real quick and kind of show you if I would use it or wouldn't use it and why or why not. And then if you have any, you know, questions as we're going through that choosing the book process, you can ask right there. And Lucy, Margie says, go lay down in your bed very nicely. Go lay down. Go lay down.
It's awesome. You tell her.
Thing with glittery, shimmery. And that you like it or don't like it, Julie. Go lay down. Margie said so.
Thanks, Kathy.
Lay down. Good girl. Down. All the way. Down.
Margie's saying she did not say that. She would spoil her.
I don't think not. I see. I did say that, Lucy. We and Tattered Angels. So you really like them. Is that what you're saying?
Love sparkle.
You could do one, Julie, where you do that on every page, and that's the background of every page. That would be super pretty. And then you could do a cover, you know, that has that on it too. There's, you know, that's the whole thing. So I am preparing. And dang it, I don't know where I set this as I was moving the studio around, because I have one that's already completely torn out and most of the pages are, all the pages in this one are glued and pockets and all those things. I really wanted to show you as an altered book. I'm just starting a series of altered books and I want to do one for every color of the rainbow. And I think I want them all to be about the same size book. So if they were, you know, as like standing about the same height and those are the same height. Okay. And maybe even the same width. I don't know, because I don't know if I'll keep them or what I'll do with them for sure. But I just thought that'd be fun to see on the shelf, to see the whole rainbow of books, because the cover would obviously tell you what color it is inside. And then just do an altered book for every color of the rainbow. So I have that one prepared. And then I found another one that the entire cover, when I took the book jacket off, is just bright yellow. And I thought, well, that obviously is a great cover for the yellow one. So I was going to show you that one and even tear pages on that one. So, but I'm not sure where I set them, you know, somewhere safe as I was reorganizing. So here's what I went downstairs and grabbed. Let's just start right here. This
I grabbed is too.
The World's Great Books, Orations and Essays, Demosthenes and Cicero. Well, already I'm looking at that spine and I'm looking at these pages. Look at these pages. I love these kind of pages that are they're not evenly cut. They're so old that they just, you know, they're not even. I love those. You can tell that it's aged. I love the marble cover. And I'm thinking this is probably a really old and maybe valuable book. So I'm probably not going to cut that up. But let's go through the process. If I didn't know, first I'm going to look at this cover and say, I love this cover. I really do. I love the marbled cover. So if I was going to do this as an altered book or an art book, would I leave it like that so I could enjoy the cover? Or if it's one that I want to do something on the cover, then maybe I don't want to use this for that. Okay, so I look inside here. There's nothing here, but it is obviously aged. And look at the edge of the paper along here. This is the book ends, right, where it's glued in, and it's not even. It is uneven paper all the way down. And the edge of the page, they're uneven. I love that. I absolutely love that. They feel, they're not super thin. They're not super thin, but they feel fairly fragile, like it's a very old, old book. So let's check this out. Orations of Demosthenes and Orations and Essays of Cicero. There's the Committee of Selection. Yeah, probably too nice of a book. Oh, look at that. The picture in front, which is Demosthenes, covered by the onion skin paper. This is Demosthenes' photograph from a marble statue in Rome.
Hey, the screen is blurry. Your camera's blurry.
Let me get it to focus here. Hopefully, there we go. Look at the published date. It's 1900.
Wow.
So I'm not going to, I mean, right already, you know, there was steps already up here that I knew that I wouldn't do that. But if that one didn't tell me, then I go through and I'm showing you the process I would go through to see, you know, if it's published date of 1900, I'm not going to tear out and glue together pages of that book.
It wouldn't be strong enough. It's too delicate too.
Is or not. It's a gorgeous book and I don't want to destroy it.
Right.
look here. Look at this. I went to turn this first page. And look.
It's amazing.
This first page was never cut.
Wow.
So it is actually together as one, supposed to be cut, but it wasn't. It got missed.
Completely.
That is a pretty darn cool, amazing book, and I'm not going to use that as an altered book. What I like, when you look at these pages with the edges, look how they're not even all the same length. Look at that. Like, you can see the edge of this page, and it's like when we do torn or ripped, we rip pages to get this edging. That's what it used to be like, and I love that. But look, I know that it disappears right there. Oh, I'm trying to be so careful. The edge of that inside page is right here. It's not even the same length as the page next to it. And they're like that all throughout. I love that. It's just, there's another one that's way smaller. And, oh, look at that. Okay, maybe that was to, this is a section back here maybe. The first one, oh, no, they're not supposed to be. Because there's writing There's writing on the other side of this page, but look, it did not get cut. Wow, I wonder if that gives it even greater value. There's another one. So there throughout that there are pages that did not get cut, which reminds me, I want to show you a really cool book before we leave. Don't let me forget. Margie says the signatures are folded and sewn in, folded, and the reader uses a knife to cut them. Really? So you're saying that the entire signature would have been sewn in, folded? I did not know that. That's kind of cool. That makes perfect sense to me, except I believe that this one is glued in. I believe these pages are glued in, not sewn in, which doesn't make a whole lot of sense because I thought that early on that they were all sewn in. Wow, that's cool, Margie. Okay, so that might make sense then for this other book I want to show you. You might be able to make sense of it for me, Margie. Okay, so let's look at the next one. This one, cool little picture right there. Now, look at this book. I'm pretty sure you can see on camera because it is really aged. Look around the edge, just how the edge is aged. It's sitting on the back. So this was green. It's a, I don't know, fairly light green, a pale green, but this is definitely brown all the way around the edge. Some could have been glued, but they would still do it the same way, so you'd still cut them. Wow. See, that's why you have to be here, Margie, not only for my comic relief, but because you teach me things. Okay, this one is on Queen Elizabeth. I couldn't really tell. Now that I know that, I can see it. It says Queen Elizabeth. But that gold is about ripped off, so that was hard to tell. Okay, so Catherine Anthony is the author, and there's the book she's written, 1929, 2025, 27, and Queen Elizabeth was 1929. So I love it, too. I love this age look. There's Queen Elizabeth.
I love this subject matter. That is amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, look at that. Okay, so this was published in 1929. That's an amazing picture right there. I love it.
Wow.
1929 in New York. Copyright 1929. So I don't think I'm going to Bluebeard's Child. I might have to read this. Wow.
Yeah, I would.
But again, it's got those pages with the torn edges that I love. But, you know, yeah. I don't think I can destroy that book either. So let's go to this one. This is called The Diversity of Life. It looks like a new book. Questions of Science is an international series of books published by Harvard University Press, Penguin Books, blah, blah, blah. Okay. Oh, look at that cute little picture. That would be cute in the book. Okay. So this one was published in 1992. All right, it's vintage, but not antique, but it's not that old. I mean, it's not old enough that I'm already seeing yellowed pages. I'm not seeing them yet.
It's probably stronger.
Let's take a look. I'm going to take a look through here. That's kind of a nice picture there on both pages that could be used. Of course, it could be left in and used as a base to whatever I wanted to put on it. Or I could tear those pages out and use them here or somewhere else. Okay, so I'm flipping through here, and this is really clean, really white, really pretty new. There's some cool-looking pictures, but oh, look at this. I was going to say, there's cool-looking pictures, but there's not a ton. Oh, my goodness, look at those butterflies. Those look cool, but there's not a ton. I'm not seeing a ton of pictures in there. Grasshopper. Okay, and then I come back here. Let me see what's before that. There's some pages like this. There's different kinds of woodpeckers. What else did I see? Different kinds of fish. See, those are good images to use.
Yeah, I love those.
Look at that with oh the koala and the numbat and the sloth. Oh, Julie, the tamandua.
It is Rue Day.
Yeah. It's Rue Day. Yeah. I was just thinking Italian Day all the way around with that. So that's a good page. But then I go quite a ways here before I find something else.
I would tear out all the pages I like and then go from there.
Yeah. So now and see about, it looks like maybe about,
oh, that's cool.
About a third of the way through the book. And this is the third one of this kind of big black and white that we've seen. That's really cool. So maybe every chapter, if those are throughout the book, maybe there's six or eight like this. Those would be cool to take out.
Wow.
Yeah. Isn't that neat? Other than
what is the subject matter? I can't even tell. It just looks like something under a microscope.
All those big black and white pictures?
Yeah, I do see an animal on one of them, because I do have a delay, but there was a couple that I couldn't even tell the subject matter. It was just awesome.
Just an awesome picture. So there's a couple good ones there, but then I go a bunch of pages before there's anything else. That's a nice one. And you could color that in. You could take that. Yeah. Here's a bunch before I get to another. Okay. So I'm starting to have a couple thoughts about this as I flip through it. And so the process, that we go now, here's some colored pictures. Here's an author searching for insects in Panama. Sri Lanka. There's some good images that might be used somewhere in an applicable. Oh, there's some cool ones, flowers and fruits. Those are exotic flowers and exotic fruits, fungi and frogs and butterflies. Look at that. Some cool exotic butterflies. Ooh, love that one. Beetles and crabs. Okay, and so there was four or five pages right there, and now I go here and I got a bunch more. That's a nice one, without anything. So my thoughts about this are a couple of things. I could use this or I could not. If I use it, then I could say, all right, each time I come to one of these images, then I want to say, do I want to leave it there and use it as part of my art? Or do I want to make sure that I tear that page out so I can use that somewhere, somehow, so I don't disturb it, and then, just leave in the pages around it. That'll just become like right here. These two would be the ones I would tear out. And then, I've got bunches on both sides of them that don't have any images on them. So the question would be, then, do I want to leave the images in or some of them? You don't have to leave all of them in. Will it fit in with what I want to do? Well, I think these images are super cool, and I think I would use them, but I don't think I would use them in my art journal. I don't think, except maybe, a couple, some of the butterflies or something. I don't think that they're... they're going to fit in with like what I would be thinking that I would want to do for my art journal. So I would probably use them in a regular journal, a junk journal or something. So there's so few of them that I could tear them out. And you don't have to tear the entire book before you get started. Is that a fungi? So I see the word science in a book. Yeah. Yes, Julie. When you see the word science, grab the book, especially if it's cheap or free. Because science often has those things that you want to put on slides, where we can just make up slides, specimen slides. You often find those in science books. Science also has, my mind just went blank, illustrations, just the black and white drawn illustrations of different things. And those are really nice, especially in layering or collaging. It doesn't always have to be a colored picture like that. Often you'll get the botanicals in the science books. That's a really cool one right there. You could color it or not, either way, however you want to use it. So, that could even make a really cool cover of a book, if you colored that. But yeah, the life and death of species. Okay, so the whole book is called The Diversity of Life. I would not even have thought that that's what it is. But I'm looking at that book and I'm thinking, all right, the images that are in it, I want to use. But I don't think I would use them in my art journal, so I probably want to take them out. But I don't have anything in mind to use them for right now, and I'm not sure that I wouldn't use some of them in there. So I'm going to set this book aside and pass by it right now. I'm not going to make a decision on whether I would keep it together or tear it up. I would not keep it together because of its age, because it isn't. I wouldn't keep it together because of its, you know, content in that it is something I can't find somewhere else or want to read or again and again, or that this is online. We hardly ever read these kind of books anymore. But I don't know that I just want to tear them out yet just for the sake of tearing them. But my instinct tells me that probably when it comes down to it and I'm ready to use this book, then I'll probably tear them out and use it as an altered book. And I will just do it a little bit at a time. And that way I can make a decision as I go. I might leave some butterflies and some plants and things in and not take it all out. So I hate to on one day do the whole book and then not have any options with it later, when later I come up with a great idea and I've already ruined the book, so it's too late. So let's see. Blurry. Okay, that would make an awesome altered or upper. I agree. I like the size. I like the strength. Now, here's another thing. I kind of look as to whether it's in signatures or whether it's glued in. This one happens to be in signatures. Signatures is more difficult to do an altered book or art journal, because everything has another side. You know, it goes up this side and it goes up this side. So when they're glued in, you can just tear one or two pages out and that's all you've disturbed. But when it's a signature, if you tear these two out, likely the other side, you know, the two that match it on the other side are going to be kind of hanging there free. So then you kind of have to look at it and plan, well, are those two that I'm going to glue to the one next to them? Then that's okay, because that gives them stability. They're not going anywhere. So, but one that is glued in is going to be an easier, more stable spine when you do an altered book or an art book. Okay, so this one, let's see. It looks like it's glued, but then from one angle, it looks like there's signatures there. Nope, I'm going to say that one's glued in. But look at these pages. Look at the aging around those pages. Oh, my goodness. I'm loving that. Loving that aging. What is this called? It's called Bismarck by Emil Ludwig, translated by Eden and Cedar Paul. All right. Bismarck. Okay. I didn't know if it was talking about the city or what, but I'm going to go back right here. Bismarck is a man. He is a person. Look at the pages. I hope you can see that it looks kind of marbled, is actually the aging. We can't even get that kind of aging when we try. And look at the edges here. We can't even get it this good when we try to do it. There's nothing better than natural. You know, the natural aging process. That's awesome.
Might inspire you.
Love that. Yeah. Okay, so Bismarck apparently is a man. This is Bismarck in 1871 in Berlin. So it's the story of a fighter. All right. So I look at this, and this one was published in 1928. So it's pretty old. It looks pretty amazing condition for old. It's historical. There's five books in here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 about different parts of his life. No wonder it's so thick. It might have some value because of those things that I just named. I love the pages, and I would love to use one like this for my art journal because I love the torn edges, and I love the aging, the natural aging on them and not having to ink them at all. Look at that in the back. So cool. You know what? I didn't even turn on this secondary light. Let me do that. Put it in here. Of course, that might make the aging look brighter. Yeah, that's just, so I'm not sure I want to tear that up because that's a beautiful book. That's pretty cool. Okay, so that's the one I'm using. So I've got, that's the one I did. Is that it? Have we looked at, I have this one left. We looked at that one. We looked at that one and that one. We looked at that one. Okay, so I've got here this one and this one, the one that I am using right now. This one, New York Times best-selling author of The Passage. It's a novel called The 12. Okay, so a novel is a great place to start because a novel is going to be printed a gajillion times, and that helps me not to feel guilt for destroying the book. This book was actually headed for the trash bin when I rescued it. I don't know who the author is. I don't take time to read novels, so that doesn't mean anything, but it was headed for the trash bin. And so I said, you know what? I like the size of that book and I like the thickness of that book. So I grabbed it. So let's take a look at it. I'm going to say that it's probably fairly new because it's, you know, New York Times best-selling author, and the pages are pretty white. So it's probably a brand new book. Copyright 2012. Yeah, so that is a new book. Okay. I just noticed something. This is printed in large print.
Ooh, words.
Uh-huh. I like that. Wow. I like that. I would have to read that one first. History, yes, and biography. Those books are amazing. A gajillion and one. Yeah. About a dozen eggs. What? Usually I have to cover up bad words. Huh.
Well, here's you got books with bad words, girl.
Sometimes you go to the Dollar Tree and you buy, or any of the dollar stores, and you buy books. And it's amazing because they're playing Christian music as I walk through there, but I open a book and it's not the best book inside. They just have these books in there and there are bad words. So when you use them for collaging and things like that, often you do have to, you know, I tore pages out of a book once from Dollar Tree and I cut them to size. I had a stack this big, I'm not kidding you, that came right out of the book. I cut them all to size. I ran them all through my envelope puncher. I had four different sizes of envelopes made, all ready to fold. I started folding them, and as I folded them, there was a bad word. And I couldn't turn it or fold it any which way, but it was talking about killing somebody or murder or sex or, you know, something that just not appropriate to put on an envelope and give to somebody or put in a journal. Wow. Yeah, so I went through that stack, and out of that entire stack of paper, I was able to save about four. And the others, I thought, I'm going to have to cover them all with napkins and make sure that you can't really see through it, which is hard. But I don't really worry about that when it's an altered book or a art journal, Julie. And that is because, man, my tongue is just like it's three sizes too big today, huh? And that's because when doing an art journal or an altered book, I know that I'm going to cover these pages. The whole point is for me to do something on the page and to try something, whether I put a piece of paper over it or whether I put paint or gesso or collage on it or whatever I do, I know I'm going to cover the whole page. Maybe not all the, you know, edge, but that's okay. So I don't worry about, in fact, this was one of those books from Dollar Tree that probably would not be so great using for some of those other things. I haven't read it, I don't know. But I didn't worry about it. After that first one, I thought, I'm going to use a Dollar Tree book because I know I'm going to cover every page. That's what I do with scrap paper. I have a gajillion in one of those. Me too. Actually, I have a lot more cardstock than scrapbook paper anymore, and I'm wanting to use scrapbook paper for more of this type of project. So, oh, don't give me an excuse to buy more scrapbook paper. But when I saw that this is large writing, that makes me excited, because on the pages that I tear out, I can go through there and remember how we went through and looked at the sentences backwards just to find sentences. I'm sorry, just to find words, not in context, just a word that we could use, you know, different places. Like right here, I was just reading backwards, glowing, whether glowing or whether glow, you know, but there, you know, hiccup. That would be a fun one to use. And it's italicized with an exclamation point. So, you know, read backwards, just find the words that jump out that you could just use. And I like it being a large print because the words are going to be a little bit larger when I put them on a tattoo.
Look for that.
Somewhere. Yeah, you can see it.
You
like that. I had
never
no
thought
idea
about it.
I haven't opened this since I saved it from the trash bin. I just went down and grabbed 5 books out of a box because I knew I had variety in every single box. So, all right. So I'm going to look at that and say it's not old. It's not. It's a novel, so it's reproduced a whole bunch of times. And it doesn't even matter what it's about because I'm going to cover every page that's left. And it's on a good side, something that doesn't really have anything to do with whether I choose to use it or not, but it's a bonus that it's large print, so I'll be able to find some words that are bigger to use, you know, on all my projects. So this, out of those 5 books, this would be the book then that I would tear apart and use for an altered journal or altered book or an art journal. And I know, looking at that, now, this is really pretty. I love these colors, but I don't want to look at this. That's not representative of my altered book or art journal. So I'll probably try to pull this tape off here that will take the library sticker off so that will be nice and smooth. And then I may just right away, and maybe we'll even do it today, but just slap down a layer of gesso so it can start to cover it. And then whenever I decide that I'm ready to do the cover. I rarely can do the cover of anything first. I don't know why. I need to do some of its guts so it can speak to me and, you know, tell me what it's all about.
Exactly.
So I love these colors, but I don't love the rest of it. So I will give up those colors for. Yeah, I don't know that I want the tape down on here, so we'll do that. But let me move these others, and let's go through the process. Let's see. Okay, I posted a paper outpost. The same thing I just posted in our group, and they removed it. What did you just post in our group, Julie, that I didn't see? Why would they do that? Sometimes there's a glitch and you can't see it for a while. I have no idea. Maybe because I give credit to the person that inspired me, or would it be because I put it in the flip through, put in the flip through video? No, I'm sure Pam would not care about that. She's all for giving credit. I don't think she'd have a problem with giving credit because she does, I think. I think I remember her. But I don't know if there's a, they have a rule about videos or any of those things. Give me your book. Your art journal. Okay, do they, you know how in our group we are really all about art of any kind? Show us what you crocheted, show us what you know, the card you made or the scrapbook page or all these other things, any kind of art. We love to see it all because it's all inspiring. So then it was removed if you received that post or that message. But I know a lot of groups say this group is about junk journaling and it's only to be about junk journaling, and they don't want people to start bringing in things about, I don't know, art journaling.
I think that's just it, actually. I think it was because she mentioned another group.
another group.
Yes, I've seen videos on there, and I've seen, because it's a paper outpost, right? Yeah. I've seen videos on there, and I've seen other kinds of work done on there that's, you know, art, but not necessarily junk journal.
Okay.
But no one mentions another group on there.
So that makes sense.
Yeah.
That makes sense, and maybe we'll flip through her rules and see what it says. But my guess is, yeah, that it's not a video. Like Sharon said, and I don't think that it would even be if you gave credit to another person.
Yeah.
But if you gave credit to another channel or another group, or put a
link, then you had video, yeah,
kind of things. Yeah. Then that I can see that they might have a problem with. Yeah, it's nice to credit.
Yeah, it comes off as a promotion,
right?
They don't,
I was gonna say, want you promoting other groups within their groups, which is why I never go post our sale notices anywhere, anywhere except in our group,
right? I know some allow us, but I feel weird about it for some reason.
Yeah, I don't. Okay, so this book that I'm using was a Dollar Tree book called "I'm Traveling Alone." Yeah, I liked that. That was actually good. And this is the one I decided to use for this Art and Soul. I love that title, Sharon. Art and Soul.
I do too. It really resonates with me.
Yeah, and this is the one from Saturday. So I like the size. You want to look at the size. How big of a book do you want? Do you want to start with just something really small so you don't feel overwhelmed with having to fill very much space? Or do you want an extra large, an oversized book because you want lots of room to put down all the pretty paper that you love? Yeah, Julie, I understand that. You're not trying to promote them. You're trying to give credit.
So, yeah, I get it too.
It's tough. It is tough. It's okay, Julie. You're entitled to feel upset. Well, post it again on our group. It'll make you feel better.
Or go back and post it without the credit given.
Well, and see, Julie's the kind of person that if she was inspired or got ideas from somebody, she wants to give them credit. And I totally get that. But
we all would.
You have to post it again without the credit given. And then you could even comment on it and say, I really wanted to include, and you did include another group or a YouTube channel, Julie. Can you just name the person without putting the group in there or the YouTube channel?
No, I don't think you're supposed to. Anything that promotes another person or channel or whatever.
I mean, that's what I mean. If it's just like if I posted something and said I was inspired by Sharon Shields and I tagged you, inspired by Sharon Shields by the such and such she did and this is what I made. You know, that's one thing. But if I wrote I was inspired by Sharon Shields of Happy Paper People and there's a link to Happy Paper People, you know, or even if it wasn't linked, it's still, you know, showing another group. But would you be able to put the name of a person without putting the whole YouTube channel?
The name of the group, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
If not, then, you know, maybe you could comment on it after you post it. Oh, or you could post it in your what you write up there. You can say, I really want to credit where I got inspiration from this, but it's against the rules. So I'm just going to show you my journal. And then everybody will know that you tried to credit or you want to credit that you're saying somebody else inspired me, but I can't. But here
I think Sam wants the post to be something that she inspired them to do, but it's not necessarily a specific thing or whatever. And if she reworded it like, oh, I was inspired this morning watching Pam create and this is what I created and then left it at that, then her picture
was really followed somebody else's thing and she wants to credit who it is. Yeah. I get that.
It walks the line.
I know of another artist that I really like her work and on her Facebook group it is you're only to post things that you used any of her digital downloads in. And I love her work and I like watching her stuff, but I don't ever even post or comment. I just look at, you know, what she does. Because I think that's tough, but you know, I do understand that that's why they started a group, and maybe some people don't like our rules, you know, why we started it.
It's a touchy subject and it's hard to figure out the right way.
It really is. It's tough. Yeah. It's tough.
You've been bouncing around with it for so long, yeah. You know,
keep running things by Sharon going, well, what if we did this? Well, why can't we do that? And what if we did this? But, you know, but sometimes too close to a line that, you know, I mean, neither of us is going to be police monitoring, you know, the line.
Right. We don't want to do that. Yeah.
She has a huge, huge group. She has to be a bit more careful. Never post in groups except paper people because I never know the rules. I am in so many. Yes. Aw. You can post any of those things in Happy Paper People.
Anything creative, you just go right ahead.
Yeah.
You can credit other people. We don't care.
Absolutely. Just don't link to other people's sales. You know?
So far that's it. Yeah.
We are going to find a way to promote our own members' things that they want to sell. I'm bound and determined to find a way to promote the things that our people make and want to sell. We're still trying to find the best way to do that. But if you are inspired by something and then I might decide that that's a channel that I want to go watch all the time because I like the style, you know, and it inspires me. So by all means, that's how we learn about new and different artists and groups, right?
We're a family supporting each other and rooting each other on. So whatever makes you feel creative and get that creative juice flowing, that's wonderful. Yeah.
And the only reason we don't want to do the sales is because
people take advantage.
We do. And it's just too easy for the entire feed to be, you know, 90% things people have. Then people quit looking because they have to wade through so much to even get through tutorials. And when you post, what people keep telling us, they love when you post what you made. That inspires them. And, you know, even if you tell where you got the inspiration from, that's not a problem at all. People love that. And they want to see the tutorials. They want to see what all the other people are making. But they don't.
Yeah, that's what we want our feed to look like that. Yeah.
I mean, we've even thought of, you know, doing a sister Facebook group that's tied to this one, that all it is things that people from our group want to sell. So if you want to see what's for sale, you could pop over there. But that's a whole other group to admin. And I don't even have time to keep up with all the things I need to do on this one. I don't want to let this one slack, you know, in order to do that. But okay, so
we'll
figure it out. Yeah, we will. And if you have ideas or thoughts about that, guys, message
me. Let me know what
your thoughts are, what ideas are. Because often we take an idea, and this is what Sharon and I do. One of us will have an idea and we'll spit it out. The other will go, I don't really like this part of it, or we can't that, or whatever. But we take one component of it and then we'll say, what about this? And we build on it. And we go back and forth and back and forth. And pretty soon we've built to a workable solution for something, even though our first thought wasn't entirely workable. But, or we may go to something completely different, but at least it got our creative brains working.
Yeah, we give each other ideas and stretch our...
come up with stuff, so don't ever think I got a dumb idea. Sometimes the dumbest ideas are the best, you know?
Or they turn into something fantastic. Yeah.
I just cut the paper there, but maybe that's the only way I'm going to get all this off.
The other thing we're worried about is people that join the group just to post their sales stuff and taking advantage and clogging up the feed and not being a part of the group, because we want We want all of us to feel close and connected and supportive and
know that somebody
took advantage of that. It's not
cool. Which is why we're not concerned about getting to 10,000 people, because we would rather have a smaller group that is amazing people. Everybody knows, you know, a lot of people and feels like they're part of the family and supported and, you know, loves being here, than to have a great big group that's just a bunch of strangers.
That's right.
Really bottom line.
With sales links. Yeah.
I don't want that.
Yeah. We'll figure it out. There'll be a way.
I'll undo Margie. Do it the hard way. A couple of mixed media groups where people were nasty to each other. Yeah, we won't permit any of that. We, so far, we've got amazing people. I find that typically, if you set the tone for the group and what you want, which I think we have, that it attracts that kind of person, which it has.
Yeah.
We've got amazing people.
What you send out comes back tenfold, and yeah, we're letting our light shine.
Yeah, and then, come on, here we go. Just 1 second. Okay. And then people who come in that maybe aren't of that kind, they don't last. You know, they weed themselves out. That's typically what happens. So hang on a second. I got to get this YouTube up here.
We've all made friends we wouldn't have made otherwise on here. We all have. Yeah. And it's amazing.
Yeah, great things that we wouldn't have made otherwise.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, Julie and Margie and I knew each other from another group, but I feel like now they're my sisters because I know them so much better. And I love them. They're amazing, amazing women. Where, you know, I think it was more just arm's length friends in the other group because there are so many people. And that's okay. That's okay. Yeah, in Linda's Lives, that's where I met Margie and Julie. Julie, Margie, I would be devastated if you ever left. I agree.
We all would. Yeah.
I totally agree. I have made a lot of acquaintances in other groups, but not a lot of what I would consider real friends.
Yeah.
Where this group, I consider real friends. And yeah, I would be devastated if either of you ever left. And Kathy, I love, because Kathy, are you still here? Kathy Lane, Kathy Dutry, there's a whole, you know, Debbie Royer, there's a whole core group of people that are always participating and at things that I have just come to know and love. And Gigi, what happened to Gigi?
Yeah, where is she?
Okay, bye now, Margie. Yeah, Kathy Lake was from Linda's too. So we all kind of communicated or had some interaction at Linda's, but it would not be, you know, appropriate to take the attention away from Linda and start, you know, building during her lives, building relationships. There she is. Yeah, you better be loving Martin. You know, if she's doing a live, then it's all about her and her live and her channel and her sales, and we're there to support her. And I still go to hers whenever I can. I have had a hard time on Monday because Doug has Mondays off right now. And so it's really hard for me to get there on Mondays. Yeah. And that's what I think it should be, that we go to other people's channels and support them and build them up. And, you know, Sharon, I know, feels the same. We're all about community, not competition. There is room for everybody, and there are things to be learned from everyone that's in our space out here. And the more people that we observe and interact with and support, the more we're going to learn, and the more our creativity is going to come out, and the more people are going to come into this, you know, creative world of ours. So I just think that's all awesome. All right, let's go to this book. I got that. Label off.
Enough
and
of that push.
I kind of, it was very expensive, and I kind of hate using it on something that really doesn't even matter. I kind of use it usually on the important things that, you know, oops, I really made a mistake there. I need to get that off, but I need it to be perfect. That's kind of what I do. Exactly about Linda. Yep. This group and you and Sharon have been the first group that I actually feel completely safe from people turning on you, even better than Friendly Junk Journal group. And that's saying a lot. Wow, Julie, that is saying a lot. That is saying a lot. And I appreciate you saying that, because that's exactly what we've tried to create. And that just gave me chills, knowing that you actually feel that way, that it's working, what we're trying to create.
Or that we're not just feeling that by ourselves.
We're just feeling it in our own minds. Friendly Junk Journal was the first junk journal group that I joined. And I still love that group. I love our little group here even more.
Closer relationships, for sure.
For what you just said. Yep. And I like us being a part of it and in the middle of it and interacting. I learned so much from you people. I mean, what Margie just taught me today about books from ancient times, I had no idea. Which reminds me, before I tear, I'm going to show you this book so I don't forget. All right. So,
Cassie. Thank you, Margie. Yes. We're so glad that you're here.
Aww, thank you.
And now we have chicken skin, and we're going to have to like talk about books so we don't cry. Okay. Cheers.
I made one mistake with this book, and that's I had some books and I was tearing out the books. You know, I always save the covers because I'm going to use the covers for different size journals and things like that. But I did not look at this book before I tore it out of its cover. So it is out of its cover. Although I do keep all the covers, so I can go find the cover and it's not destroyed. Maybe I can put it back on. You got to check this out. I've never seen this before. Margie's probably going to go, oh yeah, that's exactly what they are.
That's worth $1 million, she'll say. Yeah,
exactly. You like Julie. Okay. So this book, man, that's a nice thick book in there. Is called Europa und ASEAN, which is basically Europe and Asia. It is written in German.
Wow. Already.
Yeah. 27th of July, 1902 to 1912. That was the life of Miriam Lessing. I'm looking for the copyright 1930. Okay, so this was copyright 1930. Are you seeing this? Hi, Amanda. How are you? It's naked. Hello. Yes, it's a naked book. Look at this. Look at this. Look at these pages. Look at this.
What is? I don't understand.
Can you see that the pages are connected at the top? They never got cut.
Yeah, I'm seeing that. What?
And here's the thing. Every single page, and they're not all the same spot. Like the one that I just showed you, it's at the top, and these two are together, overlap, like kind of like a signature, and then the top isn't cut. But look at this one. This one is at the bottom, open, and this side would need to be cut.
That's
and
why
the top as well. I mean, I showed it to somebody. Oh, we're doing great, Amanda. Oh, wasn't that pretty? That I gotta give me ideas if you have thoughts about what to do with that book, because it is gorgeous. Copyright page but no date. Oh, Julie, that sucks. Okay, so I showed this to somebody and they first said, oh yeah, maybe this is one of those where this opens up, like this comes out and then it opens up into like the four pages out here. And they went, oh no, because it's attached there and it's attached there. Okay, Mark,
it's folded.
If you fold a large piece of paper into fours, you'll see the fold is on different things. Yes, I agree. I do agree. But my whole thing is some of the pages, the bottom is cut. Some of the pages, the side is cut.
Side of the side, signature.
Some of the pages, I'm so confused, Margie. Look at that. Both are cut. The top isn't cut. Every single page in this entire book. Wow. Every single page. Is that not cool? And then you get back to here. Not sure what that says. This is a little insert. Little insert. Then here's the rest of the book. Same thing. All the way back. What do you make of that, Margie? That every single page, and I'm checking to see signatures. But it's not sewn in. They're glued.
That is really weird. It's glued.
So, I mean, my thought was that, you know, they fold the pages like that. They glue it in. It's all, you know, good to go. But then somebody's supposed to be slitting these pages open.
Yeah.
Let's see, Amanda. Let me check. Where's that insert? And so I'm thinking somebody forgot to slip those pages open. Okay, the
somebody
insert
slipped on the job.
Oh, really? The insert is only a single page deal in German. And you can see right there on the spine, you can see that it's glued. And no, they're all well glued into the spine. I mean, they are well glued into the spine. It's just the rest
What's
of it.
What's the date again on that?
The date?
Uh-huh.
I wanted to say 1930. Let me double check.
So like during the war with Germany? Is that what you're saying?
Copyright 1930 by Felix Minor in Leipzig. You have an Aesop where two pages were not cut apart. It's so weird. Yeah. Yeah. So we were just looking at another one where there was a couple of pages, like at the beginning of every section, that weren't cut apart. Oh, yeah. I saw you said that earlier, Margie. You said they could have been glued. Probably the majority were sewn in. But and maybe the earlier they were, the more they were sewn in, and then later they started gluing them in. But man, I've never seen one like that. I just think that just blew my mind. It doesn't matter how many times I look at it, it still blows my mind. So now I need to go downstairs where I put all the, nope, I know where they are, where I put all the covers that I took off in a nice little bin with a lid on it, and I need to find the lid to this. I need to find the lid to this and put the lid back on. Must have had a very dull knife. So they just gave up. They just gave up and didn't cut it. They had a dull knife. Yeah. I just had to show you that. I've never, ever seen that before.
Crazy.
And that was pretty darn cool. Isn't that crazy? I just kept it sitting here because I'm like, I don't know what to do with that because I don't even want to destroy it.
How do you look and see if it's a first edition or not?
Does it usually say on it if it's first edition?
I don't know if there's a formula there or not.
Sometimes it will say in the book. Sometimes in the book it will say first edition, blah, blah, blah. I don't know if Germany put that in there. But otherwise, you can look up the name of the book and you can look up the year that it was printed. Look at the name of the book and look up the, you know, the year it was printed.
Copyright?
Yeah. Copyright, you've got the printing.
Publisher?
Yeah. It was copyrighted in 1920 and printed in 1940. It's probably been printed a number of times in between. So, brought home a lot of rejects, book rejects. people rejects. I'm a people reject. Okay, so let's go to this book. I think this would be a nice one for an art journal because it's actually pretty thick. You know, thick enough that I could tear out some pages and, put a little dimension on it and not worry about it, end up with an 8-inch mouth. So here's typically what I'll do. I'll keep this first page, which is part of the bookend. Okay. Book reject. I'll usually keep this one because it's always attached to the first one. See how when I pull that, it starts to pull up because it's not attached at the bottom. I don't know why. It's always attached at the bottom or glued in, but it's also because it's thinner. It's also glued to this first page. So I'm going to keep that one. And it'll most likely just get glued to this one because it's thinner. Okay. And then I'll typically keep, or Leslie, put the foot. these pages are fairly thin. Interesting. Only that first one, the bookend is thick. Okay. Then I'll typically keep about four. So that the front becomes, and depending how thick they are, maybe two or three. I'm going to keep four. I'm going to keep four right there. Okay. So I'll keep four and I'll turn those over. And then I'm going to tear out two. Now, if I was using a book like that one that had all the images in it, then I would look through like the first 10 pages and say, ooh, on page six, there's an image that I want to keep. So I want to tear that page out. And on page nine. And so then I'm going to figure it out and organize accordingly so that those two pages I can tear out and it doesn't end up throwing everything off. So I saved four. I saved the first two, the bookend and the one attached to it. And then I saved four. And now I'm going to tear these two out. Now, that doesn't look like it's going to tear very nicely that way, so I'm going to go like this. Okay. Now, I don't care about these tearing or cutting. I don't want to cut them because if I cut them, which I tried, tell you all my mistakes, I tried cutting them, and it's too difficult to not cut into the next page. And if you cut into the next page, then you're at least wherever it's cut, separating it from the spine. And so then you do art on it and then it gets a little heavier. It ends up breaking out anyway. Now I've got those little things down the bottom here from the two torn pages. And okay, I'm going to leave it like that. I'm going to leave it just like that and you'll see why as we go. Okay, so then I'm going to turn two and these two are going to end up being glued together. Now, this is where you really have to maybe trial and error and see what you like, what feels good to you. In this one that I just started, I put the book in and there wasn't one attached to it there. So I kept that one. I kept that one. Okay. And so then I started here. I kept one more. Nope, I kept both of these and I glued them together. So that's the first two. And then I kept this one and I tore out two in between it, glued two together. And then I kept two. So if I tore out two and then I kept two, that's one, two. And then I tore out two and I kept two. That's one, two, right? You can't see those little torn out parts in between. That's because those are the ones I glue together. And I just let that give it extra stability at the spine. So this is torn. I will take this and glue it together. And now I have clean pages on both sides. But that those little bits there that are they're attached to the spine, it's just going to give it extra stability at the spine, in my opinion. As you know. What is it? I-M-H-O. In my humble opinion, that's why I do that. Okay. So I just tore two and turned two. And then I tore two and turned two. And I glued them all together. I see I dripped glue on the end of there. Okay, so this is glued together. It's needs a little bit of glue right there, but there's two glued together. So I tore in between it, tore two, and then glued those two. So that's as far as I've gone. I haven't torn anymore or glued anymore. And the reason...
You don't make all those choices right at once. Yeah, that's hard.
You can say this is the way I want to do it all the way through. I don't want to do anything dimensional. I want it all to be flat, and I want as many pages as possible. So I'm going to tear two, save two, tear two, save two. And you could do that all the way through, and then your book is ready to go. And then you can go back and glue all the two together, and then all you have to do is do art in it. But I thought to myself, I don't know. I might want... Like this one actually has some dimension. I've got some brads on here. I've got some flowers. This is actually, you know, probably a quarter of an inch little word tile sticking up. So that's actually, here's a little wooden center to that flower. It actually is taking up some space there. So it's not going to close exactly flat, no matter how much I push it, because that word is in there. But maybe there's some techniques and things I want to try. And I know it's going to, you know, I'm going to end up with some, needing some space in there because I want to try some mixed media things. So then I might say, all right, so then I'm going to turn two, and now I'm going to tear out four. Or even six. Oh, my cut book. I made my own uncut book with that German one, right? I would have taken. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. You know, we make journals and we make our own books, but think about, I didn't do that, Margie. All it is bigger pieces of paper, right? And folded, and then the signature is sewn in. But we do that when we make all the little cubbies and pockets and things like that. So I could say, all right, I'm going to tear out six here. One, two, three, four, five, six. Wow, that's a lot. But that would sure give me a chunk of space for doing a mixed media, you know, some mixed media, something there.
Something larger, thicker.
Yeah. I did tear it down. I haven't glued ahead, but I have torn some out. So let me show you.
I did make pockets here and there ahead, a couple of them. I made some pockets.
I tore two right there, and then I saved two. And you can see by my leftovers here, if they're really sticking way out, I'll do that and pull that out. But I'm not going to worry about the little stuff down there because I do think it's going to give it extra stability. So I tore two, saved two. I tore two. So I did go probably a quarter of the way through the book, maybe. Turn two. So tear two, turn two.
It's do while you're watching TV, too, if you want to do the whole thing.
And turn two. And there's another two torn. Turn two, one. Two. Okay. So that's as far as I went because there's no, maybe some stuck together. I turned three and then I tore on the mirror down there. Maybe I started tearing two, three, turning three. I tore two, turned two, turned three. Okay. So apparently I tore two and then turned two and then I tore two and then turned three. And maybe, as I'm thinking about that now, I did this one quite a while ago, but the reason I think I would do that, as I'm thinking about it now, is some pages that have, if there's three glued together, will give it some extra stability. And if I wanted to do some heavier techniques, try out some, you know, some mixed media elements, I have your page is going to support it a little bit better. So, but that's as far as I went. And I stopped. That's the last one I tore out right there. So that's only as far as I went through the book. And I want to go any farther because I wanted to work with it a bit and see what I thought. Because maybe I would like the, you know, three together better than the two. But see, like on these pages here, there's two together. But then I've got a scrapbook paper on this side, and I've got scrapbook paper plus embellishments on this side, so it's now more than four pages thick. More than four. And I haven't even done this page. All I did was put a base down. So I really feel like having the two pages and then doing this stuff on top of them is plenty thick for me, probably, unless there's some technique that I'm going to do. Let me see. Wonder what people think when they notice we're doing these things to their books. Well, future generations will think when they find them. You know,
I would hope to think it was sexual.
I think a lot of the generations below us aren't even ever looking at books because everything is digital. Everything is online. And so,
right,
you know, books around, I'm seeing more and more books from different, you know, resources going to the trash bin. More than I ever saw in my life before. It used to be in a community, lots of people wanted to go get the books that were going to be going to the trash bin because everybody loved to have books in their home and read. And now everybody gets everything online. So not as many people do. So I don't think that the future generations will be upset as far as using the books. But yeah, no. What do you think when they saw this stuff? I don't know. Think
we
about
saved it?
Found one from our grandmas. Yeah, if I found one that my grandma had done, I think that would be really cool. I would love to get a little bit of insight to her, you know, good or bad, based on art style. That would be really, really cool. And you know what? It's highly possible. We'll just take the whole box of them and toss them. Margie, I agree. They might. They might go, wow, this is just a bunch of trash.
Mike Dunn already cleaned my stuff, so he'll make sure that it gets passed down. He already asked if he could have all my stuff when I die.
I'm with Kathy. I like the feel of a book when reading it. I've read books online, and I do. Sometimes it's the only way I can get them, but I still get books from the library. Right now, I order them online, and then you can drive up to the curb, and they give you the library book because they're not open.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely. Huh. But yeah, I still love the feel of a book when I'm reading it. I do. And I like to be able to go back and look at something or whatever. And it's so much easier than doing it digitally. I don't know. But I'll tell you, I had a tough time at the beginning of junk journaling, tearing apart a book because I love books. I've been reading since I could hold a book. I love books. And Julie, I saw your question up there about the glue. I'm going to get to that. I love books, and it felt so disrespectful to something that I love. And then I started to think about it and see that, well, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to tear apart or alter a book that is of value or that is a one of a kind or is a first edition or is just one that I love, you know, all those kinds of things. I'm not going to. So I'm not just destroying every book I see. The books that I'm going to tear apart and use are the books, first of all, that are headed for the trash bin. Because in doing this, I really feel like I'm giving them a second life, a second purpose.
Honoring them.
They were just going to the trash bin. And to me, it's sad for books to be going to the trash bin. It really
recycling.
Is. It really is. Or, yeah, recycle. But this is recycled and still giving honor to the book that, you know, was a book. So I don't feel badly about that. I feel like it's serving me in many ways. And as I tear out these pages and I can go through and use phrases or words, numbers, all kinds of things, then that book is serving me and bringing me joy for every single project that I'm using it for. And isn't that what books were intended for? So, you know, just don't tear apart a book that has great value.
You know, there's probably a lot of copies of them too.
A novel that
if they are old, they're falling apart.
Yeah. If it's falling apart, it's being thrown away. You know, if it's a novel, what there's, you know, 5 million of them printed and it's on audio too, I don't feel bad about that because
no one cares.
Sometimes I go to the thrift store and I can see 5 or 10 or 15 of the same novel. You know, people read them and then they donate them, and that's that. Well, that's just taking space on the thrift store shelf if nobody's going to, you know, buy them and use them or even read them. So I would take one of those, buy one of those, because there's a dozen others sitting there, and then use that one because I'm not taking something that, that could be read and enjoyed. Okay, so Joy, you have another good one too. Okay. I used to be Kindle. And when it died, I don't care. I like to hold an actual book. I do too. I do like to hold an actual book. Let's talk about glue. And when you say you have another one too, Julie, are you talking about another question or something else? So there's primarily, when I'm gluing the pages together, primarily two ways that I glue them together. And that is usually a glue stick. That's Elmer's Craft Bond. Works pretty well. I do find that it, on any glue stick, and including this one, I have to put lots of glue stick. Yeah. I have to put them together quickly. I do have to put them together quickly. You know, or it just kind of dries up. The other thing that I do is my glue pot, which is just tacky glue with a little bit of water in it. So I'll
makes it wet.
I'll use either one of those. And yeah, I'll just take it and either just glue the whole page there or with a brush, you know, brush that over. And yeah, the tacky glue does make it a little bit wet. Yeah. But you know, but when you glue it together and then you're doing stuff on top of it, I found that it doesn't matter. It straightens right out. So hasn't been a problem. This page right here is glued together, and this is one that I was showing on Saturday night. One way that you could make a pocket is you could fold it down, you could fold it over, and then you could just glue it right down here, and then you've got a pocket here, you know, glue it across the bottom too, obviously. And the only reason for doubling it, you know, gluing the two pages together is for strength, because one page might be too thin, although we could, maybe it won't. Maybe it won't. I wouldn't want it to get torn out at the binding, but maybe. I just thought because you're folding it here, so it's got two layers up there. You're folding it down here, so it's got four layers down there. Depending on the book and the kind of paper it is, I think in this book, one page would work, and that makes it not quite as thick. So you could do that and tuck something in there. I mean, you could tuck a favorite pen and pencil in there that you like to use, or your Stabilo, the black one or whatever color that you might, you know, go around images and things like that. And I don't mind playing with that a little bit, because if I don't do that and I pull it out, I'm going to be covering it with flat paper and it's going to be just fine. So no worries on that. Julie, what is your other, so that's what I would do for gluing the two pages together. As far as gluing the things on, I do it just like I do a regular journal. If it's paper, it goes on with art glitter glue. And if it's fabric or fabric type paper, you know, anything like that, lace, anything that might have any issue sticking, lace or even like this tile, I did Fabri-Tac. So I only use those two because I know that they're going to hold forever. They're not going to come off. And like you can see on one page that I pulled up, they're glued together, but there's a little part of it coming apart right there. And I think I used the glue stick on this. So right along the edge here. So I'll take art glitter glue actually, and just run a tiny bead along the edge and put that together, because that's going to,
afterwards, there's always pages I have to touch up when I'm doing the page.
All right. Do you like read books? Okay, question. That gold lacy part, is that embossing or something else? Yummy. Are you talking about this right here? Sorry. I just got a real frog in my throat. Are you talking about this up here, Julie? This cute little gold lace? Because this little piece of lace here has gold on it. And that lace is sewn into, I'm sorry, that gold is woven in with that lace. And then there's this on the corner, which is gold. And there's this here, which is the same as this here, that is gold. Yeah, you'll have to go look. Let me, I think it's right here. I'm going to grab it. I'm going to grab it too and show you. And we have... Okay. This is a gold bullion. Just a regular paper doily with gold on the back. And it was folded. It was folded like this. Excuse me. There we go. Like that. Like that. So some of it was even tearing because it was folded and I'd had it for quite some time. Folded together and around something I don't even remember. And so all I did was bring the gold doily over and set it right here, decide exactly where, how far I wanted doily to be. And then I glued it right there. And then I put my fine little scissors and just cut it off right there. So that's just a gold doily. That's all that is. It does look like cool embossing though, doesn't it? I guess actually these doilies are embossed, so I guess it is. But I didn't do it. I just glued the doily on. This right here, these gold leaves, all this is trim. I've had this trim forever and not done anything with it. And then suddenly recently I've found several times I put it on and it's just turned out so pretty. And it is just a gold foil, white on the back, kind of, sort of. Like a vine, leaves, gold foil leaves. And so I just cut off as much as I want and, you know, and glue that on. So here's the funny, this is how this progresses. When I did this, and I did this up here in the corner, and I put the gray up here, and I had the little bees up there, and I wanted something, you know, because they looked, the edges didn't look right together. And so I put this up here and it goes to right here and stops. And then I wanted to put this flower that I'd made from our All About Flower Month. I wanted to put that somewhere. And I thought, well, that I'll just put that at the end there. Then it's kind of like it's hanging off of that vine. And I put that there. And then I put these things down here and I went, well, this needs something down here too. And so I grabbed the vine and I stuck it underneath this side of the flower and went, what if I stick it under this side of the flower and it looks like that flower's on the vine, but the vine goes all the way. I mean, you just never know what you're doing. You just do something, you know?
Everything leads you to the next step, right?
Yeah. I knew an art teacher that always said, if you get stuck and you don't know what to do, just do something. It really doesn't even matter what you do, just right. Do something. Even if it's just inking the edges or
just getting started.
Taking one. You know, I want to have this gold on there somewhere, so let me put a little bit of it somewhere. Just get started. Just put one thing down. And then this is just a little bit of gold trim. It's really fragile, and I have these long things of it. And so I'll use some of it, and then I'll end up with these little teeny snippets off of it, and I keep them because they're so pretty. And so that's the corner. And then I put a little bit by each of these two stamps, just to highlight it, give it a little bit of gold here and there. That's all. I'm feeling like this butterfly needs some gold on him somewhere. I might need to just use a gold, I don't know, glitter pen or something and give him a little spark right there. Chat just went really fast. I think chat was stuck for a bit. Oh, no. I can see you, Gigi. Let me go back. Yeah, while I was talking, I didn't look at the...
It actually was kind of frozen. Nothing was happening until Gigi's comment there.
Yeah, so I saw Gigi said she posted her last tinies for the month, so I'm anxious to go see those. Yeah. So Gigi, you were thinking of starting an art journal book, something like that, too. Hey. You were there Saturday night, weren't you, Gigi? Yeah, that's this lace or this one? This one's just a doily. And sure, it came from any of the dollar stores or, you know, any place you get the doilies. But at different times of the year, they'll have different colors. And then this lace, I don't even know for sure where I got it. The back is nothing, you know, just the white. And you can see that it just has the gold woven in. Just thought, well, that was just a nice little trim. So I can see Gigi, last two messages, yes. Oh, thank you, Julie. I appreciate that. So now Margie can see it because it just went flying. Oh, yeah, if you can find some of that at Red Dollar, grab a few of them because it's cool. It was all wound around this thing, and I'm like, yeah, maybe I should just find somebody who'll use this and give it to them. Didn't know what to do with it, but I'm glad I didn't. I think I had two of them, and I think I gave one of them away. I wish I hadn't, but that's okay because I'll find something new. And I can't keep everything forever because then I don't have room to get something new, right?
I'm there.
Oh, did you get a chance, Gigi, to go back and watch the beginning of Saturday's live about art journals? And I want to go back and watch the first hour today about art journals because we really talked about art journals a lot. Margie, are these gold leaves paper or ribbon? They are paper. They are paper that's wound around this spool because they're pretty fragile and it's the only way to keep it kind of sort of in a cohesive manner. And yeah, if I don't keep it around this, these little leaves end up just bent everywhere because, you know,
not it's like kind of a foil, isn't it?
It's all they are is paper. Well, it's like gold foil on top, but it's just paper. Yeah.
I've seen it in green also. I don't have any.
You've seen it in a green. Was it a metallic?
It was just green. It didn't. I've only seen it in pictures, and it didn't look metallic to me. It looked a bit shiny. I mean, it looked like it had a smoother finish, I think.
Yeah.
But I don't think it was foil.
Okay.
How would you feel about when you're done with this? Maybe I'll just do my video live while everyone's here. Later, when you're done, of course.
Do that. And if you want, we could end it and then start another one. Everybody knowing that we're just going to do that, so that yours starts from the beginning with a tutorial.
Yeah. And will you hang out?
Yeah.
Uh-oh, my phone is ringing. It's been in the stand the whole time, so.
Do that. Okay. So, yeah, let's finish up. Let's just a little bit here. We went through, you know, keep the front page, keep that little box attached to it, keep that, what do you call this, the title page, and I'll usually do a couple right after that. So there's turn two, tear
can't
two.
Hear for some reason.
You can't hear? Uh-oh. Hang on. Can you hear Sharon? Sharon, did we lose you?
I cannot hear.
Check yours and see if you accidentally muted it. Well, you can't. You don't touch it. Can everybody else hear me? I didn't mute myself, did I? Can y'all hear me? Oh, I'm going to wait till somebody tells me that they can hear me before I keep going. Margie, can you hear me? Julie, can you hear me? Kathy, can you hear me? Gigi can hear me. Yay. Margie can hear me. Okay. So maybe on this one, I'm going to turn three and tear three. One, two, three. Okay. I want to get it as close as possible, but I'm not going to worry about ripping it all the way down to the spine because I really don't want to do that. If you rip it right out of the spine, then you're making a gap. Like right there, you can see those three pages that we just tore. And they're still glued into the spine. So if I was to go to this and pull that out, it makes a gap where they were glued to the spine, which now weakens the spine. Now you can hear me, Sharon, because you're off. Okay, so we just tore What did we tear? Three? We should, yeah, three. So I'm going to turn three. Gigi, before you came in at the beginning of this, we went through a bunch of books and, oh, see, see? No, I'm not going to show that. I'm going to tear it out. That's not a good Gigi, we went through a bunch of books and discussed how to decide, you know, what books to use or not to use and why. Okay, so I turned three. And now I'm going to tear three. I mean, I have to be careful because they're glued in and like that one wants to, ooh, that's kind of a signature. It looks like it's a glued in signature, or is it just that page is glued to that page? Oh yeah, just that page was, had a sticky to the other page. So I want to be careful. I want to get it as close as possible, but I don't want to get it all the way out of the spine. And one, two, three. One, two, three. And I'm going to leave that there for stability on the spine. So tear three, turn three, tear three. Now, there's another technique in an altered book. Well, altered book is different than an art journal. So what we did Saturday and what we've been talking about, you know, is an art journal here. But once you tear the book like this, I mean, you can use it for an art journal or an altered book, either one. And there are different ways of creating in these besides what we did here, you know, what we're doing in this. An art journal is putting your art out on there, which an altered book is too. So is a junk journal. So are any of those. But the difference is I am going to create an art or an altered book with probably a theme or something in mind, like we would a journal. So I might do a journal of a certain theme, or I might do a journal that's general because I want to sell it. I might be doing it for a person, or like I told you, I'm going to do a series of altered books that are for each color of the rainbow. So I might, you know, I'll still have to design everything in it, but everything will be around purple or blue or whatever. So it still has a theme. Where the art journal, I'm just going to sit down and kind of start playing around and just see where my soul wants to go that day and what my soul wants to try or create. Or maybe I feel stuck and can't do anything, so I'm going to grab some art supplies and just try them out on those pages and play with them to get a feel for them, and it'll evolve into something. But that's kind of the difference. So if you're doing an altered journal, there's another way to put them together as opposed to building the page right on top. So you glue these. Should go back and I didn't see if I have a brush here. Oh, I have one that would work. I didn't grab a brush to do this with. And then Gigi, you missed. I'm going to glue the two pages together that are over that torn page. So that gives me more stability at the spine. So here's an idea. So we turned to at the beginning and oh no, turn three. So those three would go together. And so this one and the next two would go together. And then this one goes over the next two. See, that's not. So if I turn three, tear three, and you go to glue two pages together, remember you turned three. So now you've got three in there. You have to grab a second one on one side or the other and glue three together. So we're gluing three together, tearing three out, making a little bit bigger space. Gluing three together, tearing three out. Now, some people will turn two and tear four. Some people will tear six out and turn eight. Tear six and turn eight, or vice versa. So that's why I say just do one to start. Don't go all the way through. Do a few ahead so that you can start gluing some pages together and just start playing with it and see what you like. You might say, this is just entirely too many pages. I want to tear out six. and then turn four, and then tear out six and turn four. You know, you might want to do that, whatever it is you like. And it might depend on what you decide to, you want to do in that book as to how many you tear out. But say you get these now glued together. Okay, so that's glued and this is glued. And this is going to be an altered book, not an art journal. Something strange is happening. Chat's not working correctly. Are you guys? Sharon, check your chat and see if it's on live, not on not on top chat. Make sure, yeah, make sure it says live, not top chat. That'll make a huge difference. Last two messages can, oh, wait a minute. Here we go. Okay, so the last four messages I see are Sharon's and then Margie. All of the cute kittens, YouTube broke the internet. Yeah, really. Oh, everyone's comments from 8:30 on disappeared, not just mine. Really? I'm on live. Chat just keeps freezing. Okay, so can you hear me okay, Margie, on live? So chat's being weird. Chat is freezing, but the live is still okay. Is that what you're telling me? Yeah, I can see. I've got it up on YouTube on another device, and I see that it's totally frozen. Okay. I do want to know. Margie or Julie, somebody message me through Messenger on my phone and let me know. Julie says my comments are not showing up, but Julie, I want to know, can you hear me? Can you still hear me? Because I won't keep talking if you can't hear me, but if you can, we'll keep going. We'll finish this up and we'll end it since it's all freezing weird. And then we can start another session and let Sharon do her tutorial live today. Well, I'm waiting for somebody to tell me. Oh, Gigi can hear me. Margie can hear. Yay. Thank you. Okay. So I've got this glued and I've got this glued, we pretend. And I'm turning this into an altered book, not an art journal. And my altered book is of a theme of something, whatever it is. I'm trying to look for something that I can use as an example. Okay. A couple weeks ago, I did this one in our Saturday night, and I haven't done anything with it yet. And I actually want to use it in one of my books. But so here's another technique that you can do. If you don't like working on this or it's not very flat, you notice that this is out pretty flat, but that's because I put this book underneath it. If I didn't put that book under, it goes down like this and it pops up and it's not. This just gives it like a table and makes it a whole lot easier to work on because it is flat. So you just find something that's of the right height and put it underneath there. Yes, you can hear. Don't see any chat. You can see no one. Yes, I hear you. As long as you can hear, we'll wrap this up pretty quickly. So this other technique says that you can take whatever you want to. Oh, they all just loaded. That's crazy. You can take whatever you want to make on this page. Say I wanted to use this as the page. And I then embellish this page and do whatever I'm going to do on it. Like, it was a lot easier to do this stamping and inking and stuff, especially because I could get around here, than if I had done it directly onto this page. Maybe I want to sew around this page. And so I'll go sew around this page, probably just these three sides. And I'll complete the whole page. Then I bring it back and then I glue it in right here onto this page. Now I'm going to ink the edges of this. This one isn't the exact same size. I would cut it to be the right size if that's what I was doing purposefully. But then I'm going to glue it right on here. And so now it looks like I did the page right in the book, just like every other book, but it's sewn around here on the sewing machine. And that boggles people's minds. How did you sew around that page? The page is still in the book. You didn't take the page out of the book, but yet it's sewn. That's pretty fun. And if on the back, so these two are got three. These three are glued together. And if on the back of that, I also do a page that has sewing on it. Now both of them have sewing, and so it looks like it's been sewn all the way through because you're going to have a front and a back. Make sense? Oh, wow. Refreshed, and now I'm way back in chat. That happened a while ago. It's not going to current chat and have it on live chat. Well, Margie, nobody else's chat is even coming through for me to see, so that's nuts. But so you don't always have to create in the book. You could create outside the book and then add it to the book. So you can do any kind of technique on that you want that you might not be able to do in the book. Just another thought. And we'll do that another time. Maybe in one of my altered books, I'll do some different techniques and show you those. So, okay. So, oh, you're all having problems. That's awful. Well, okay. So why don't we go ahead and end this, and then I'm going to go in and create another one. I will title it, I'll need to talk to Sharon and ask her what the name of her thing is, because I want it to be the title of her tutorial. And so it might take me up to 5 minutes to do it. Probably not that long, but you know, if it is up to 5 minutes, depending how quickly I can get to her. And I will title it Live Tutorial and Discussion on blah, 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 whatever Sharon's is. And I'll also need to see if she has, see if she has a picture that she can send me so I could put it in there for that, because I didn't have one, so I just grabbed the Hangout, and kind of an ugly picture, honestly. I didn't plan enough time ahead to grab a good picture. I hope YouTube cooperates too, because StreamYard seems to be fine. So maybe if we end it and then we're doing a whole new stream, we can get a new link and everything will be good there. So if you didn't already do a thumbs up, please do that quick. Before you leave, and potty break, get something to drink, get something to eat, and then go to the channel, Happy Paper People, and watch for that other one to pop up to be live in just a couple minutes. Okay, guys, I'm so sorry that happened. You just never know what's happening with YouTube. Yeah, the chat is really awful because I get a random chat from somebody, and then it's completely gone and frozen. So, okay, I'm going to go ahead and end it. I'll see you in just a couple minutes. All right.